Consistently getting a good night's sleep is one of the best things we can do for optimal health and wellness. Unfortunately, as high-charging, high-achieving physicians, sleep is sadly considered a luxury in our field. For many of us, bedtime is often a very hasty affair. Our evening ritual may consist of quickly washing our face, brushing our teeth, and rushing, diving into bed. And we literally sprint into sleep rather than allowing our minds and bodies to ease and gently transition into a restful state. As an emergency physician, I'm no stranger to poor quality. And with a rotating work schedule in any given week, I will work an early morning shift followed by a late afternoon shift to then an overnight shift. And with such inconsistency, how does one get good quality sleep? So adjusting our routine and creating new habits will make sleep a priority and transition hasty nights into a more restful and complete end of our day, giving us the quality of sleep that we need for our overall health. So let's make sleep a priority. And there's a growing body of evidence and the realization that chronic sleep loss affects our physical and our mental health. And it starts quite innocently, right? Such as minor headaches and irritability. And then it could quickly escalate to a lack of good decision-making and unnecessary risk-taking. Finally, it can evolve into depression and increased risk for obesity, cardiovascular disease, and diabetes. So friends, Dr. Tim Rohrs, he's the director of research at the Sleep Disorders and Research Center at the Henry Ford Hospital in Detroit, Michigan. He has published one of the first papers on sleep deprivation and decision making. And in his August 2004 study in the journal Sleep, he and his team paid a group of sleepy and fully alert volunteers a sum of money to complete what seems like a seemingly simple computer task. And at random intervals, they were given a choice to take the money and stop, or to continue with the potential of earning more money or losing it all if the work was completed with an unknown remainder of time. That's the key, an unknown remainder of time. And in his paper, he writes, the alert people were very sensitive to the amount of work necessary to finish and the risk of losing their money if they didn't. And he had mentioned this in a 2004 New York Times article. He goes on to say further that the more work they had, the more apt they were to stop. Without fail, the sleepy people chose to quit when it was optimal to continue, and they gambled losing it all by trying to finish the task for more money, even when it was 100% likely that they would be unable to finish. So why do we sleep? Why do we sleep, friends? Well, there's a neuroscientist by the name of Matthew Walker. He wrote an absolutely best and probably the most eye-opening book that I've read recently on the importance of sleep. Why We Sleep, which is the title of his book, is filled with decades of sleep research and startling information on the harmful effects of suboptimal sleep. In an incredibly unsettling book for me to read, as it highlights many of the patterns I used to practice until I made some very important changes. So Inity says, if you are sleeping for less than 7 hours a night, you're doing yourself a disservice as grave as that of smoking. So the book is written beautifully with bits of sarcasm as well. So as an example, he pulls in the reader by writing things such as, quote, scientists have discovered a revolutionary new treatment that makes you live longer. It enhances your memory, makes you more attractive. It keeps you slim and lowers food craving. It protects you from cancer and dementia. It wards off colds and flu. It lowers your risk of heart attacks and stroke, not to mention diabetes. You'll even feel happier, less depressed, and less anxious. Are you interested? Again, these are types of quotes that he writes about in his book, and I think they're fantastic. So let's talk about some action items, friends. 5 ways to boost your sleep quality. Number 1, create a restful environment. Thermal environment, specifically the proximal temperature around your body and your brain, is perhaps the most underappreciated factor determining the ease which you will fall asleep tonight and the quality of sleep that you will obtain. Ambient room temperature, bedding, and night clothes dictate the thermal envelope that wraps around your body at night, and that's from Matthew Walker's book. Your sleeping environment drastically impacts your sleep. You can set yourself up for bedtime success by making a few simple changes. Keep your room cool, quiet, and dark. Associate your room with sleep and avoid things like browsing the internet while lying in bed. A cool room can improve the quality of your sleep by stimulating melatonin production, and that's what we really need. Recommending a specific range depends on what is comfortable, but most experts recommend keeping the room around 65 degrees Fahrenheit, which is optimal for cooling your body towards sleep. Keep noise to a minimum and consider drowning out any distracting sounds with a fan or a white noise machine. And finally, use blackout curtains or a sleep mask to block out light and prevent it from interfering with your sleep. Second thing, friends, is to disconnect from devices. Technology is all around us, and you may not realize the extent with which these devices have on our bodies. The reality is that using electronic devices before bedtime can physiologically and psychologically be stimulating, and this is primarily due to the shortwave blue light that is emitted from these electronics. When a person views bright light at night, their body can react the same way it does when exposed to sunlight, hindering melatonin release. So these devices delay our circadian rhythms, making it more difficult to fall and stay asleep. Over time, this not only delays the onset of REM, but reduces the total amount of REM sleep we're in. And this compromises our alertness and productivity in the morning. So friends, letting go of electronics is key. And you do this by initiating an electronics curfew for you and your family. Do whatever is realistic that you can consistently follow. Even 30 minutes is a start. An excellent substitution for electronics is reading. While print media is a great choice, ebooks are incredibly convenient and affordable. And I found that using an e-ink e-reader, such as the Kindle Paperwhite, as opposed to an iPad or a Kindle Fire, doesn't produce the same type of blue light that delays the sleep. If an electronics curfew is not practical and you must use electronics at night, set your phone to night mode and dim the screen light to decrease the amount of blue light exposure and the brightness of the screen. Third thing, friends, is to focus on your breathing. Breathing exercises are helpful tools that can help release the stress from the day and transition you to sleep. Take slow, deep, intentional breaths before you sleep, and it provides many therapeutic effects on the mind and the body. I use box breathing, which was developed by Mark Devine. He's a former Navy SEAL commander, and is especially useful for calming the nervous system before sleep. The benefits of box breathing include reduces physical stress from the body, it positively impacts emotions and well-being, increases mental clarity and focus, and improves your future reactions to a stressful situation. And that's a huge win when working with critical patients. The method of box breathing is relatively simple and straightforward. Sit upright and in a comfortable chair and close your eyes. Inhale slowly to a count of four. Hold that breath for a count of 4 seconds. Exhale slowly for a count of 4 seconds and hold it. Exhale for a count of 4 seconds, and it's 4 steps, each 4 seconds long. The fourth thing I could recommend, friends, is relax your body with a gentle stretch routine, whether it's a particularly rough shift in the emergency department, medical wards, or in the operating room, or maybe from spending most of your day behind a desk. You may find that your body is sore or tense at the end of the day. So incorporating a gentle stretch routine before bedtime will help you relax, release the tension, and slow down your nervous system. And when you gently stretch before bed, you allow the body to recover and regenerate, lengthening your tight muscles and promoting flexibility. So there are many different stretches that promote a better night's sleep. I found that Tom Merrick from Body Weight Warrior has a very quick 14-minute evening stretch routine that is easy to follow and very effective. So again, Tom Merrick from Body Weight Warrior. And if you're looking to recover from a specific injury, for example, and you want to learn more about the mechanics of stretching and the recovery process, Kelly Starrett is the person to go to. He's the author of Becoming a Supple Leopard, and he's got a website called MobilityWOD.com. He's the leader in this field and has an incredible library of online resources for you to choose from, so make sure you take a look at that. Finally, friends, relax your mind with journaling. I use the 5-minute journal to put a close to the day. Writing in the evening serves to learn from the day's events, hold myself accountable, and encourage my subconscious mind to process for the next day. Tim Ferriss, who's an American author, entrepreneur, and public speaker, describes journaling as not a way to solve your problems, but rather what he describes as a need to get them out of your head, where they will otherwise bounce around all day like a bullet ricocheting inside your skull. A journal is a great place to write down ideas, offer gratitude, and set short and long-term goals. So there's a recent study in the Journal of Experimental Psychology suggests that we write in a journal for 5 minutes before bedtime. What helps best is not writing about what you accomplished that day, but writing out your to-do list for tomorrow. And this helps relieve worry and stress and manage your feelings about having incomplete work. The ultimate goal of writing is to provide you with an outlet and to promote better sleep, whether it is used to write down what you are grateful for or to create a to-do list. Writing serves as an easy way to transition into restful sleep. So friends, to conclude, you have to create these bedtime habits. It'll take a little work at first, but creating bedtime habits take time and dedication. If you find that the process of adjusting your routine seems awkward or overwhelming, you can start with small changes. And remember, what works for one person may not work for somebody else. Although I have had success with my own sleep routine, what works for me doesn't work for my wife, for example. My wife struggles with creating a consistent routine because she finds that other factors, such as the kids, can disrupt her routine. So for her, small changes work best, and I encourage you to do the same. I've had many setbacks in the past and at times have failed to make sleep a priority. I've learned, however, that getting a good night's sleep is one of the best things we can do to reset our mind and body, and is one of the greatest ways we can invest in our overall health and well-being. So friends, I'm going to leave you with this. Sleep is an investment in the energy you need to be effective tomorrow. That's a quote from Tom Roth. So start today. Use the tips that I've given you to start you on that journey. So until next time, friends, be good to yourself and each other. I hope you enjoyed this show. And if you did, make sure you hit that subscribe button. But also, very importantly, make sure you share it. Make sure with your friends and your colleagues that you feel that may find this useful. So until next time, be good to yourself. We'll talk again soon. Bye-bye.